What is up, you guys? We are checking out Hex Shards of Fate, the free-to-play TCG/MMO from Cryptozoic Games. I'm joined by Corey. Corey, would you introduce yourself to our viewers?
Hi, I'm Corey Jones. I'm the president and CCO of Cryptozoic Entertainment, and I'm here very excited to show you Hex.
It's cool. Let's get into it. So I guess the general idea is you're trying to blend the world of an MMO with the play of a TCG.
Absolutely. So the high concept for this game is that MMOs and TCGs have something in common. And what that is that they rely on a community to make them work. And when we talk about all the great things about an MMO, typically it really stems from your ability to play with a lot of other people and create relationships and explore together and have all this amazing gameplay that brings people together to work as teams or to challenge each other. And the feeling that we had at Cryptozoic was that a lot of that would be absolutely one-to-one applicable for a trading card game. And so most MMOs are third-person action RPGs, and the idea we had was, what if you replace that element with a trading card game?
I'm so down with that.
So everyone, the response that we've had, if you've seen the Kickstarter, has been, remarkable. We are absolutely blown away by this amazing community that sort of rallied behind this concept. One of the great things about, an MMOTCG is the idea that all the things that are so important to a TCG, because I was just talking about the MMO, all the things that are so important to a TCG really revolve around the opportunity to find someone to play with. I mean, anyone who plays trading card games will tell you the biggest barrier to entry is typically finding someone else who plays. And so going to a tournament in a hobby store is awesome, and it's a ton of fun. You get to play with other people, but those things are pretty limited in availability. There's one night a week or a couple days a week where you can get down and play. And it's also difficult, schlepping all the way down to a hobby shop,
and
especially if there's none in your area, becomes real hard. And for many people that maybe have aged out of the hobby a little bit because you're now got a job and a family, it's difficult to find the time. The great thing about video games is that you get to play on your own time. Mm-hmm. And when the kid's been put to bed, it's 9 o'clock at night, and it's my chance to have some game time. I'm certainly not getting in the car and driving down to a hobby shop.
Be a little weird.
Yeah, but I love trading card games. I mean, and this is for me, and I think a lot of people. There's a lot of passion, and trading card games are this just amazing experience. And so the idea behind Hex was, how do you create this digital trading card game experience that also rolled in all the amazing community elements of an MMO and really gave me the opportunity to have the best of both of those worlds?
Awesome. So could we check out the character creation real quick?
One of the great things about the game is that you have the opportunity to engage in some of the fun things in an MMO, like all of the sandbox components, and really create your own unique identity in the game. So I want to say, you'll hear me say it many times during this is pre-alpha, and so a lot of this is very placeholder right now. The heavy lifting for a game like this is really the engine that runs the trading card game mechanics and the AI behind that. And that's the part where we're very far along. We're nearly completed with that. All the other elements, all the interface elements are sort of bolted onto that, are the parts where we're doing a lot of polish and we're building those systems still. So you're going to be able to create a new character. You're going to actually select a race. We have two different factions. We have the Ardent and the Underworld.
Right on.
You're going to pick a class. You're going to pick a gender. And you're going to then make a character. So some of this stuff is not working. So I'm showing you some of the interfaces that actually do not work.
That's
I'm going to go back. And then once you have your champion, you're going to be able to level that champion up, and you're going to have a talent tree. And the talent tree is broken up into three different elements, and each of those elements is very specific to a type of deck build.
Mm-hmm.
So it may be that it is the aggro deck, the combo deck, the control deck. And as you go through, and if you go to our website, hextcg.com, we have an entire article written about this. You're going to be able to make decisions about how you spend those points as you level up in those different trees to give yourself different buffs, and those buffs become these nice handholds to how you're going to build the decks. So some of the buffs may be something like a special card. Like in this example, I have the Fury build gets four copies of a card called Cleave, and Cleave deals damage to X number of up to X damage to a couple of different troops. Mm-hmm. And so those become really interesting things where it's like, oh, the warrior has this special card. It's kind of a build around. I'm going to make a deck where that really works. But then you can change it around. So we're going to give you the ability to change your builds on the fly. You make the decisions about the build while you're actually building the deck. And so it's going to save your champion to the deck, and you may rebuild him and save him to a different deck in a different way. The character creation process.
Sweet. So can we actually jump into a match real quick?
Yeah, absolutely. One of the great things about a digital game is that we get to just create cards on the fly. So one of the things we talked about earlier, we were talking about like the booby trap cards, where it's I actually shuffle cards into my opponent's deck. I mean, that could never be done in a physical TCG, but it's trivial for us to do it and just opens up this amazing design space.
Yeah, it's so awesome to be able to do these things that you really can't do.
Right. So the way it works for equipment is that each card, each of the PvE and PvP cards has two pieces of equipment associated with it. And when you make your champion, he has six slots. And so you're actually able to go in and in those six slots put a piece of equipment. And there's a head slot, a chest slot, boots. And depending on which one of the pieces of equipment you put on, it then modifies the card that it's associated with. So as an example, and I don't know what it is specifically, that would have been super slick if I did, but for Zoltog, let's say Zoltog had a pair of boots, and the pair of boots would say that Zoltog now is able to attack right when he comes into play. Or potentially Zoltog would do 1 point of damage to my opponent at the beginning of the turn, which then triggers his effect and makes a guy. So we've come up with, and again, because it's PvE and it's, you know, you're against the AI, I want you to win. I want you to have a good time. And then the AI is really hard, and those decks are really hard. So we make sure that the equipment are just these really wacky, fun effects. And I think people are going to flip once they start to see just how much of a sandbox this game is.
Yeah, it seems like there's huge potential for different interactions between cards.
Oh, it's incredible. The socketed cards, which we really didn't talk about much, but the idea that you're going to be able to put gems into cards and fundamentally change. I mean, you ask most TCG players, what's your fondest dream in a TCG? And they're going to say the exact same thing. I want to design a card. Like, you know, for we've had that as the prize for big tournaments is, you know, you get to design a card.
Mm-hmm.
So this is as close as you can get to that without having to work at a game company. You're actually able to sit down and look through your collection, take the gems, take the equipment, and radically change how the cards work and come up with these just absolutely bonkers decks. And everyone that we brought into Cryptozoic, and we brought in a bunch of, you know, gamers, everyone we brought into Cryptozoic to check this game out has lost their mind. I mean, they... are their jaw drops, and as they start to look at each of the cards, and then we show them, like, oh, here's the list of the equipment that goes with it, it's just like,
it's too much.
It is. Can't take this.
All right, so sorry for the technical hiccup. Let's get back into this.
All right, so as you can see here, clearly the superior Hex player is well in the lead. I'm now casting...
As it should be.
So I have Zoltog, you know, the I buffed him up. He's a 4-4 that when he does damage to the opponent, he creates... These guys, Savage Raiders, mm-hmm. So I got two of him. And actually, he creates guys for every orc that hits the opponent. So now the Savage Raider will create another Savage Raider. I just cast Gore Seeker, which has Swift Strike and Rage. Rage is when she attacks, actually gets a +1 on the front end permanently. So she gets bigger and bigger. And so now I'm going to go into
my... This is about to get...
really bad for...
this is a beating.
Basically. Yeah, this is a beating. So I'm going to go ahead and attack with these two guys. And we'll see what he has up his sleeve. I don't think it's much. And
so your troops do they can't attack the turn they come into play?
No.
It's a typical balance.
Oh, he did. He had the Ruby Lance. So he's Ruby Lancing one of my guys, but it's the guy that we created was... Oh no, he Ruby Lanced Gore Seeker. Oh, that's a lot of nerve.
What a jerk.
Yeah, unbelievable. So you can see again, as I've mentioned many times, pre-alpha, so you know lots of the effects need fine-tuning and polish. So these both of these guys are going to hit, and so now it creates, again, two more of these guys. So you can see how the cascade effect on this.
Mm-hmm.
He needs a card that's going to do damage to the entire board, although I don't think he has it.
He's boned, pretty much.
Yeah, pretty much. We'll give it back to him. Let's see what he does. Maybe he's got some big trick up his sleeve. Sapper's Charge. That is not a big trick. That's not going to help him. So you can see... We talked about threshold, so you can see on some of these cards, you know, they have the one threshold.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the cards have no threshold, so in this case, artifacts are, you know, without threshold. And
Very cool. So what kind of card types are we talking? You got troops, artifacts, what else will we see?
Yeah, so you're going to have actions and quick actions. So actions you can do during your turn. Mm-hmm. Quick actions you can do at any time. We have constants, so those things come into play and stay in play. We have troops. We have artifacts. And I think that's pretty much it.
Yeah, that covers all the basics. Now it's time for a pummeling here.
Yeah, I think this is
this
probably...
This is curtains.
I think this is pretty much game over for him, so we'll go ahead and hit him with everything. Oh, I did it again. I forgot to use my charge power. Well, he used the charge power, so at least he was on top of the top is showing you off. And that's, again, I would have pressed this button and it would have created that 3-1 blaze elemental for me.
Right now we're looking at the ruby style deck, which is aggression. What do the other colors do?
The other resource types are the ruby is, you know, a lot of direct damage, very aggro.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the wild, as an example, has, you know, big creatures. It's got some sort of, you know, the Shinhair, which are you know, sort of feudal rabbit clan. They have a lot of, you know, creating tokens and buffing those tokens. We have a lot of, you know, making troops better in the wild resource when it comes to the Sapphire, you know, card manipulation and, you know,
tricky stuff.
We also have in Diamond, you know, healing and defense. We do have a whole element to the game where sort of the factions and the race matters. And so, for instance, the humans are in both, you know, are in Sapphire, Diamond, and Ruby, and the humans have a keyword called Inspire. And what it says is that it has a trigger effect, and when you put you may have a 1-1, like the Kraken Mariner, the Kraken Guard. He's a 1-1 that comes into play with Inspire, and when you cast another troop that is cost 1 or greater, he gets +1 to his defense. So, and there may be a guy that costs 3, and when another troop comes into play, they get a bonus to their front end. They get a bonus to their attack based on the attack level of that card. So Inspire is this really great thing where the cards that come in after the person with Inspire that cost as much or greater than get some kind of bonus based on that card. And that keyword is very much a human keyword. So okay. Race matters in this as well, and we built around that as you know, a really great tuning mechanism.
Very cool. All right, so for the final swing, I think you should use that charge ability. You've been saving this moment.
He only has 2, so I can actually just attack with. So he's using another one. Okay, he's killed off one of my guys.
It's not enough. Not enough.
No. So I'll use it now. So I've used my charge ability. I've created the Blaze Elemental, and now it's gonna go into my.
Just all in right here.
Yeah. We'll go into my my attack step. So I'll hit with these two guys. I'll leave those other guys back, even though they can't block. I don't want to be, you know.
Just
don't want to be too embarrassing for them. And again, our very placeholder victory screen.
Oh, yeah.
With fireworks and all. This is what commonly referred to as programmer art.
Very cool. So that was just a quick look at Hex Shards of Fate. When do you think we'll be seeing more of this game?
I believe that we're shooting for beta in September.
Cool.
And then from there, if everything goes great, the hope is that we could get the game out before the end of the year.
Awesome. Well, if you want to learn more about Hex, go to hextcg.com or just go to gamesradar.com and we'll see you there.